has been a real joy to be outside and nature. And I feel like I hardly have to do anything for y'all to have a spiritual experience. although I gotta say, how lucky are we with Yasmin? Yes. We were tapping into it. I was not present this morning in that first song. I was not even, I didn't know what was going on. And then you got us moving and into our bodies and facing the sun. I'm here now. So thank you for bringing me to this place and making me aware of the spirit that is already all around us. So we are in the middle of this is the second week of a 4-week series here at Valley Mountain on our core values, the main parts of our mission at Valley Mountain. So last week we talked about deep listening, and this week we're talking about our second core value, which is creative liberation. We're calling it threads because these values, we kind of separate them out so that we can be coherent and we can have a conversation about it, but really they weave together. These values create the fabric out of which this community does our work and connects with each other and connects with those beyond this place as well. So it was really great to spend some time last week getting into deep listening and what that means, because yesterday I had a class of 25 seminarians come to the CoLab, and the first question was, what is deep listening? And I was like, well, let me tell you. It's not about information, it's about transformation. I just gave my sermon from last Sunday, and they're like, wow, that's well stated. And I realized that we have these values, and many of us know them, especially people who have been coming around for a while and getting really involved, but we had a hard time often talking about them. And so that's why we're really getting into it, and that's why I used alliteration this week, you know, cheat sheet in your bulletin, about what is this thing we call a creative liberation. It's a pretty cool term, and it's meant to be artistic. All these values are meant to be not like extremely to the point and concise and whatever. They're meant to be expansive and to kind of let you put some of your own spin on it and let it take us in different directions. And yet at the same time, they're rooted in something. It's not just some words that you put whatever you want. And so today I'm going to share about 4 different aspects of creative liberation. So earlier this week I was actually in Minnesota with 10 pastors or community leaders, not all were ordained, more like lay leaders in their communities from around the country, talking about building community and what church is for. It was this kind of interesting thing in a Benedictine monastery in Minnesota. And it was interesting for me because a lot of the networks I'm part of are more kind of the activists or the creative, or kind of the weirdos of the church world. And this wasn't that. It was a very kind of normal grouping, and so I felt way on the outside most of the time. One other guy in the room that I was like, that's my guy, and we sat next to each other the whole time. but everybody else had these different perspectives, and it was kind of a good reality check for me. So we started talking about our churches and stuff, and this one guy is older, conservative evangelical pastor from Minnesota, of a church where he said, you know, we have Fortune 500 CEOs and big-time lawyers and all this kind of stuff. He said, after a while, he came up to me and said, you and I are pretty different, huh? I said, yes, sir, I think we are. He said, yeah, it's so interesting to me. You know, you're talking about systems and changing systems and all that stuff. In my church, I tell them, it's not about systems, it's about people. And, you know, people make up systems, and so it gets up there, but really the church is for working on people. And I think that's a theory of change that might be true. Like maybe if the system doesn't change until people change, then that might be true. But he wasn't arguing about how does change work. He was saying this is the point of the church. This is the point of the body of Christ. This is the point of the Spirit. This is what we are here for. And we fundamentally disagreed on that. Here at Valley and Mountain, we believe that the church is absolutely personal. It is about individuals and spirits and kind of the interior life, absolutely. And it's political. It's personal and it's political. We can't just reduce this whole thing that we're a part of, this whole movement, the divine, the creator of everything, to individuality and our personal, emotional, spiritual journeys. It's bigger than that. It doesn't have to be exclusive, one or the other. It's inward and it's outward, and that's a pretty core value. If the church is the body of Christ, then we like got to look at what the body of Christ did. And what the body of Christ did was bring good news to the poor, liberate liberation for the captives, freedom to the oppressed, proclaiming the Jubilee, which is the cancellation of debt. I mean, there's like an actual economic piece to this thing. Jesus in his first sermon said, I'm here to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor, which was this passage in the Hebrew Bible about canceling debts and freeing slaves. Basically, inherited wealth and inherited debt were to be no more, so that we could actually have some equality in that society. So if deep listening is the value that kind of talks more about our inner lives and being personally transformed, then creative liberation is a little bit more about our outer lives. It's the call to impact the world for liberation. And so I put these little alliteration things in the bulletin so you can try to, I'm going to say some stuff and you might go, that was nice, and then forget about it like immediately after the service. That's what happened to me a lot when I'm listening to a nice talk. And so I'm trying to avoid that. I remember I used to work at the summer camp after college, and we'd have like 100 youth come to the camp, and we'd put them to work painting houses and stuff. It was a small town in West Virginia. And I'd meet 100 people every week, and I wanted to remember their names so we could build a relationship. And so I had this little thing where it'd be like, okay, Hank, nice to meet you. In my head, I thought, Harry Hank. And, you know, Sally, okay, Slimy Sally. Even if she wasn't slimy, it was just like a way to remember it. So, trying to give a little tool to make this memorable. So there's four C's in creative liberation. By the way, I don't do that with y'all. I'm not like, you know, Dave, like, Dirty Dave. Maybe it. So here's the four things about creative liberation that make it distinctive and that make it different than just a synonym for social justice. Sometimes we kind of use those interchangeably, and we specifically picked a term early on that wasn't social justice to try to give it some more meat and some difference from what that means. So first of all, creative liberation is confessional. It is not self-righteous. I don't know if there's many activists here. I do know there are many activists here. If you're not all activists, I am. If you're in those circles, there is a lot of self-righteousness. There's a lot of belief that we are right. We are in no way part of the problem. It is all those guys, those people, them. Sometimes we don't even know what them is, and we end up sounding a lot like the same people who we're so frustrated about. Creative liberation is not self-righteous. In the story that Moses gets sent to the Pharaoh, the story that we just heard Juliana read so beautifully three times, Moses' response to going to Pharaoh is, who, me? You want me to go? Instead of like, finally, someone's noticed how righteous I am. It's like, I don't think I'm really the guy to try to lead people out of this situation. And I think that there's a humility in that that we need to be paying attention to. Activists love to be right and pure. We love to be right and pure. And yet, creative liberation acknowledges that in some way we are all complicit. It's not the same. Different ones of us are complicit at different levels, but on some level, in some area of your life, there is complicity in this system. When Dr. McKinney, the Reverend Dr. McKinney, the great civil rights leader of Seattle, came and preached here in February, you know, he's the kind of guy you could be like, well, he's not part of the problem. He was this great civil rights leader. But his message was, does anyone remember this thing he kept saying, without mercy, without mercy, who could stand? I mean, this is like a civil rights icon and hero, and he's not sitting there being like, it's all them. He's saying, like, we all have something within us that needs to be worked on, that needs to be given up, that needs to be released, acknowledged, confessed, and changed. Even in a man like that, without mercy, who could stand? So creative liberation is confessional. The second is creative liberation is confrontational. It is not passive. A lot of folks, confessing is as far as they get, and the church has been guilty of that for a very long time, as though confession is all you got to do, and then that's it. We realize we're broken, and oh well. Activists can do this too, or people who are motivated to change the world, they can get stuck, we can get stuck in guilt. White guilt, male guilt, whatever kind of guilt that we might have, whatever incredibly useless, unhelpful thing that it might be. Incredibly stuck in that and end up wallowing it, almost enjoying it. We sometimes think all that's necessary is to be aware, but that is not it. God didn't tell Moses, go read books about the problem of slavery and write in your journal and figure out, you know, when you buy it, it's a different store and then from the slaves, you know, buy different bricks and the slaves make and then you'll be good. It wasn't like this personal awareness is it kind of thing. He said, go face off with the leader of the great global superpower, this military superpower of the world. Go face to face, toe to toe with this person. God tells Moses to confront the Pharaoh. Now, confrontation, it doesn't always have to look like marching in the streets or, you know, banging on the door of a big company or a military complex or whatever source of power there is in the world. It doesn't always have to look like that. I think at some point, if you haven't done that, you should try it. And I'm happy to introduce you to that world. but that's not the only way it has to look. There are many different ways that we can get face to face with these issues and be willing to put ourselves in the line and be vulnerable and stand up to something. But it takes more than simply awareness. The third, so confrontation is confessional, it's confrontational, it's creative. It's not just critiquing. It's not just saying these are the problems of the world and we're mad about it and we don't like it anymore. That's part of it. We don't have to have all the answers. But Moses isn't sent by God just to lead them out of Egypt and to end slavery. God sends Moses and the Israelites into a new vision of life, into a new land with new rules, with a new system that ends up taking the rest of the Torah to really talk about. Now, a lot of the Torah is these laws that might seem kind of ancient and out of date, and some of them are. And a lot of them are about kind of religious practices and how big things in the temple are supposed to be. But a whole lot of these laws, maybe the majority of them, are actually about economic justice, social justice. It's about the construction of a society that doesn't exploit people and harm the poor the way that their society has been in the past. He leads them to a land of milk and honey, to a mountain where they will worship God. And if we read this kind of Jewish idea about what worshiping God means, it's not just standing before the experience of the universe and feeling really amazed. That's part of it. But ultimately, worshiping God means doing justice, serving those who are less fortunate, making their agenda your agenda, and confessing. That's what it means to worship God on God's mountain. It's embracing an alternative to the God of empire and an alternative vision for society. So if we're going to do creative liberation, we can't just say no to a bunch of stuff. We have to say yes to something as much as we say no to this, yes to that. It takes a lot of work, and it takes a lot of humility come up with something and realize it's not that great and still go for it and then try to change and evolve as we go. We don't have to have it be perfect the right time, but we have to offer something to a world that's so cynical and skeptical. And finally, creative liberation is rooted in courage. And this courage comes from beyond ourselves. In the story when Moses says, I cannot believe that you're sending me to Pharaoh. What does God say to him? I will be with you. I will be with you. That's actually when Jesus is promised in the New Testament. One of the names he's given is Emmanuel, which means God with us. One of the core ideas of this faith is that we are never alone. Especially when we are allowing ourselves to be transformed and working for transformation in the world, we are never alone. Creative liberation is not just social justice by another name. It is rooted in the assurance of grace, the power to confront, the creativity of the Creator, and the courage given to us by a source beyond ourselves. You are not alone. God says to us, when you go to the Pharaohs of this world, I will be. The creative liberation is confessional, confrontational, creative, and courageous. Four C's. What fun. This is the end of my reflection, and I'm going to invite y'all to turn to a couple people around you. If you need to kind of be meditative by yourself, that's fine too, but I invite you to turn to one or two people around you and talk, what does creative liberation look like? What is this stirring up for you? What might need to change in you to live more into a life of creative liberation? We'll take about 5 minutes.